boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. I will boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. He's worthy.
Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, or the strong man boast in his strength. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. Let the humble come and give thanks to the one who made us, the one who saved us.
I will boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. I will boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. I will boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. I will boast in the Lord my God. I will boast in the one who's worthy. He's worthy.
Take. The Lord breaks the yoke of bondage, and he takes your sin away, and he lifts you from the grave. And if you're feeling that, let me encourage you to just ask the Lord to just pour out into your heart and your mind this morning. This is your time to commune with him as we gather together, so just ask him to pour it out. Pour out your spirit, Lord. Pour out your spirit, Lord. I want to be like Jesus. I want to be like Jesus.
Pray it out.
Pour out your spirit, Lord. Like Jesus, King of glory, Lord of your face I seek, your name I come, Jesus, 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 you are holy, you are, your love is great, and your mercy.
Oh, Jesus, take my heart, every part today.
King of glory,
King of glory, Lord alone, your face I see, your name I call, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
My love, my life. hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Lift it up, hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how it gently lifts me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising. I can feel it rising. All the love that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. This God's song rising up in me. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Yes, it makes me sing. Lord, you make me sing. How you make me sing. Yes, you make me sing. Lift it up. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah. 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 Your love makes me sing.
You know what makes me sing when I think about his love for me? Is I think about what I'm capable of. You know? I'm thinking about maybe some of the things I said this last week that I shouldn't have said. And here's the thing that's a kicker. He knew that I was going to say them. He knew that the things I did, he knew that I was going to do them. And I love that scripture that tells us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. And when they queue up the line for ungodly, I got to think sometimes I'm like, you know, now serving number two, maybe number one. But he's so good. I mean, his love is enduring. And he's good, and he loves us not because we loved him back, but we love him because he first loved us. And now we're just here just enjoying that, aren't we? God is good. Would you take a second, stand up, turn around, and tell the person next to you that God loves them? God loves you.
Good morning. Welcome to Refuge. Good to be at church. Good to be at church. A few quick announcements for you, and then we can get church rolling. So we're back from spring break, and that means that we're going to kick off the Bible studies once again. So we're excited about all of our Bible studies. The ladies, the men, and the couples group is going to start this week. So we're going to get in the swing of things. You might have seen some signups. So the signups are outside. So ladies, if you can sign up. And you guys are going to be going through a booklet with Beth Moore. And so the booklets are $20 if you'd like to go ahead and take care of that at any time and sign up. Men, you can sign up as well. Those of you that have not attended the men's group, we meet at Mario's house. There's directions back there. Mario and Sonia's house. So directions are back there outside. And we're going to be going through 2 Timothy. And it's going to teach us how to be a man. Right? Right? So basically what Pastor Howard is telling us is that we're not really manly. So he's going to teach us how to be men.
No, the point is, Ray.
Well, that's what I thought.
Let me school
you. That's
what
I was thinking.
When Pilate stood Jesus up in front of all of the rulers in Jerusalem, and he stood him up in front of all of the Jewish leaders, and something he said after Jesus had been beaten and endured so much, he stood him up in front of everybody and said, "Behold the man." And if there's anything that you know, most commentators believe is what he was saying is, here is the fullness of a man. And, you know, I don't mean to condescend to anybody. I don't think anybody here is not a man. But I know that everybody here is not the man that they would like to be. And we want to be everything that God has created us to be, men. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So we're going to get together. We're going to crack open the word. We're going to get tacos in our bellies. We're going to hang out, you know, that kind of stuff. So we're going to do man stuff. Okay. So anyway, go ahead.
Go ahead. That's why he's the pastor and I do the announcements. See? All right, so we have a couple birthdays. Sammy's birthday. Where's Sammy? Where's Sammy? Leslie. Sammy, stand up, Sammy. You're standing right in the front, Sammy. Yeah, it is. They tell me to do this stuff and you got to have to do it. When's your birthday, Sammy? Okay. It's right around the corner. It's right there. And then Leslie, 13th. Awesome. Happy birthday. We're going to sing you guys happy birthday. Any other birthdays?
What?
Jube, what are you doing? Stand up, Jube. Come on. Jubilee. You can't get it past us. All right. Anyone else? Any other birthdays? Yeah, I heard, yeah. You're going to have to stand, too. It's all right. Don't we all get embarrassed all together. All together. Stand up for us.
Yes. This is community humiliation. Here we go.
Another one.
Nice.
All right. When's your birthday? Last Sunday. All right.
Where were you?
All right. Yeah, right. We didn't see you last Sunday. Where were you? It's all right, don't tell us. It's all right. Shh.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Jesus loves you. Anyway, happy birthday to you.
All right, thank you. So before I let Pastor Howard pray, we're going to go ahead and excuse our little ones, children's, young ones that way.
You guys got it?
Junior high school, you're going to stay here because our high school people called in sick. The usher's going to come forward, but first let's pray. Father, would you bless tithe and the offering. Lord, we bring it to you as a service, Lord, that we might not only receive from you, but we would deliver and be a part of what you do. You invite us in, so God, we just ask that you would bless this tithe and this offering. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship his holy name. The sun.
Thank you. powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
We have to pray for somebody collectively this morning. His name is Miguel, and he was diagnosed this week with stage 4 bone cancer. And so he's going to undergo treatment, but I think before he undergoes treatment for what is wrong, we want to pray for him and take him before he goes to see regular physicians. We want to intercede and take him to the great physician. So, Miguel, you want to come on up here, please? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Miguel. Everybody say, hi, Miguel.
Hi, Miguel.
I brought some oil.
Okay.
Okay? Está bueno?
Sí.
Sí? You guys could extend a hand here, and as I pray, we'll just join together and we'll pray for Miguel. Father, we ask that your hand would be upon Miguel. Lord, that you would touch his body. Lord, that you would just give him peace and rest. But more importantly, Father, we're asking for divine intervention. We're asking for your hand to be upon his body, that you would cause the rebellion in his body to cease, and that you would bring peace to it. Lord, as cancer is nothing more than cells rebelling against cells, so God, we're praying for order. And Lord, I pray that you would keep Miguel in perfect peace as his mind is fixed on you. Thank you for what you've been doing in his heart and his life. God, continue that work and be with him. Be his advance and rear guard. Be his strong tower. God, be his ever-present help in a time of need. And we just lift him up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you have something to pray for in the coming weeks and months, we've been praying for Tina, of course, who's undergoing treatment. And you look good, Tina, I have to tell you. You look beautiful. So we just keep these guys, keep them in your prayers. They certainly need it. If you do not have a Bible, please pick up your hand and one of these ushers will get one to you. Once you have it, I want you to turn in the Gospel of Luke, the 6th chapter. Luke chapter 6. My grandmother was the head of the United Methodist Women's Prayer Group. She was also the head of the United Methodist Women's Bible Study. She was faithful till the day she stepped into eternity. And my grandmother was an interesting person. Her name was Ruth Beatrice Tennant. And she said this to me. I got this from my grandmother. Birds of a feather. Oh, did your grandmother give you that one too? I know mine did. And I discovered in life, and it didn't take long, I discovered in life an amazing truth, and it's this.
She was right. She was absolutely right. Your friends will determine the direction and the quality of your life. You are who you're surrounded with. As Paul wrote in the letter to the Corinthians, when you're surrounded with people with corrupt morals, it corrupts good character. And so, if my friends will determine my destiny, my future, the quality of my life, this is what this tells me. That you can pray a prayer, you can believe a verse, you can embrace a truth, and still not realize a positive change in your life. You can do all of those things and still not realize real, positive, and productive change in your life. You do not have community. You won't have change. If you don't have the right connections, the right associations, you will not get far. And believe me, life is sometimes, and we talk about dysfunctional behavior, sometimes like a flat tire. It's not going to change until you change the tire. You're not going to fix it until you change it. And get this in your brain. And I've heard this many times. It's not what you know, it's who you know. Yeah? This is why I'm glad you made it today. Because I'm about to lay some things on you this morning I hope you walk out of here with. It's actually a game changer. And what is it? It's church. Church is a game changer. Church has been a game changer for me all of my life. It has meant more to me than I can describe. See, church is not just a building. As I told the people on Tuesday night, this is not just a building, and this is not just a meeting. This is not just a group. This is not just a group of people. But this is a supernatural collective. This is a supernatural manifestation of all that God is on the planet. And this is what Jesus came to establish and create. The right way with the right people. Verse 12, we read. Now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. When you pray all night, that means that you have something to pray about. In other words, you don't just pray. This is important. The only time that we read that Jesus prays all night is right here. And Jesus has been at odds with the religious rulers for months and months. And they've been back and forth. And they want to kill him. And what is the rule that he broke? What did he do to ruin everything? I'll tell you. He had the audacity to heal a man on the Sabbath. And by the way, this isn't the second time he's done it. Or this isn't the first time he's done it. This is the second time. So they've had it with him. And the truth is, it wasn't because he didn't know. I mean, I believe he knew that this was all a setup. And they were just waiting for him to step over the line. But he was on mission. And his mission was always the same. It was healing. It was hope. It was help. That's what he was all about. And so he knows their thoughts. And he knows that they want him gone. And he knows that the clock is ticking. He can hear it ticking. Time is essential. The pressure is building. And people are breathing down his neck. And what is at stake? Verse 13. And when it was day, he called his disciples to himself. And from them, he chose 12, whom he also named apostles. Apostles, they were the ones who would be sent. The word is apostolos in the Greek, but it means something more than just being sent. It means that you're a recognized delegate. You're an authorized attendant. You are a messenger sent from one who delivered or one who provided the message. He's going to have to train up people who are going to carry on the work. He will have to pick the right people. This is important. People who would endure, people who will succeed, people who will constantly rise to the occasion. So he prays all night for direction. Now, by the way, as a side note, I want to step off for a moment here and pull you into a concept that is so powerful that oftentimes we blow by a few verses like this and we don't see it, and it's this. He's praying for direction. If you're going to take note, write down pray. You can even do the numeral four and then the word direction, okay? He has the power, he has the means, he has the wherewithal to pick his own guys, the right guys. He can do anything he wants. Instead, he prays and he asks for direction. What do you want me to do, God? And two other times in this book, we find Jesus praying, saying this, your will be done, not mine. Not my will, but yours be done. So most of us, for most of us, and I maybe it's just me, but most of us, when we hear that, it's kind of a weird prayer. I mean, how often do we actually really pray, thy will be done? You know why? Because I know what I need. You with me? I know exactly what I want. I know what I need. I already know. I already know what job I want. I know what house I want. I know what apartment I want. I know what roommate I want. I know what life partner. You name it. I know the car. I know the make, the model, the year. I know what to pray for. I have it down. But not with Jesus. He's got the power to do anything. Instead, he's going to God and asking for direction, not provision. I'm going to say that again. He goes to God and he asks for direction, not provision. And I think, and I wrote it down, what if the Lord didn't want to provide for me because he knew it wasn't time for me to have it yet? What if what I want, he doesn't give because I'm not ready for it? What if the waiting is preparing me for the receiving? See, I think because we live in a world where we want it now, we want it all now, we immediately, ready, fire, aim, we pull the trigger. We close our eyes, pull the trigger, know what we want, and go for it, not realizing that quite possibly in the waiting, God is preparing not only us to receive, but preparing what we need to receive for us. Show me, Lord, lead me. Lord, point me in the right direction. This is the great process when you pray. If you're taking note, ask for directions. Most of the time, the problem is not having what I need. It's fully using what I have. Are you hearing me, folks? Put it this way. Jesus has got disciples. I mean, well over 70. He's got disciples coming out his ears about this time in his ministry. He could pick anyone. He has to train the right people, has to look for the right people, men with the necessary tools, the right ingredients, men who he would endow with supernatural power, with the ability to heal, to stand against the combined forces of earth and hell against them. And after praying all night, Jesus walks down that mountain. And has anybody here ever done flag football? Or has anybody here done dodgeball? You ever done PE where they pick out the people? They always pick out the two studliest people in the class. They're the captains. And they begin to pick the players. And don't they always pick the strongest players first? That's exactly what we do. We pick to win. I think it was John Wooden who said this, if you give me the right players, I'm an amazing coach. So you pick to win. You pick to win. So what does he do? Let's read verse 14. Simon, who he also named Peter. Peter, by the way, is always named number one. He will lead. But there's another side to Peter. There's the emo side of Peter. There's the ego side of Peter. By the way, your ego is not your amigo. Ego is nothing more than edging God out of the equation. And Peter had an uncanny knack of edging God out of the equation. Do you remember? Do you remember Peter? Peter was packing the pointy personal protector when Jesus was getting arrested. And what does he do? He whips out his sword. And what kind of amazing damage does he do in protecting his Savior? He hacks off the servant of the high priest Malchus's ear. Most people believe. I mean, how does a right-handed, most people would be right-handed. How does a right-handed man hack off the left ear of a priest servant? Some people, I think it was Gail Irwin who said he thinks that maybe Peter was running the other way and just flailing backwards as he was going. That's Peter. Peter is the guy who is denying Jesus. Do you remember the night that Jesus is getting worked, like, you know, getting worked in Annas' courtyard, in Caiaphas' courtyard? He's getting worked, and Peter's outside warming himself by the fire. And a little girl comes up and says, "You were with them." "Oh, no, I wasn't." He denied it three times. This is who he picks first. And then there's Andrew, his brother. Andrew, his name literally, it means manly. He was physically strong. He was a tough guy. But get this. Do you know how he came to Jesus, by the way? He used to hang out with John the Baptist. John the Baptist. I mean, John the Baptist, he's a wonderful prophet of God, but oh my gosh. He's wild honey and locust and burlap. I mean, burlap, camel hair, outfit. There are scenes. They deny anything having to do with the flesh. They're tough. They're a tough guy's tough guy. That's Andrew. And he's used to roughing it. So he's naturally one of the two to follow. Then there's James and John, the sons of thunder. If there were ever candidates for anger management in the Bible, it would be James and John. You hearing me? Do you remember what happened with the Samaritans? The Samaritans would not offer up hospitality for Jesus and his posse. So what is James and John's concept? What do they think we should do? They said, "Jesus, let's call down fire on them. Let's burn them all." And Jesus, he responds, you do not know what manner of spirit you're of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. They were not, by the way, these guys were not above a manipulation. They put their mom up to trying to get them leveraged into the right and to the left of Jesus' ministry in the positions of power in Matthew 20, 21, and 22. She said to him, "Grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one in your right hand and the other on the left in your kingdom." Jesus answered, "You do not know what you ask." By the way, every disciple who was hearing this just could not stand the brazen manipulation that was going on. And Jesus answered, and he said this, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I'm about to drink and be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with?" And they said, did you see that? "We are able." Translated, James and John, we got this. I mean, how, by the way, when he enters his kingdom, on the right and left will be two thieves nailed to a cross. Do you think Salome, their mother, thought, "I am glad he didn't answer that request"? 14 again, Philip. Philip was always just a little weak in the faith department. Do you remember when we're feeding the 5,000? Over 200 denarii is not enough to feed all of these people. In John 14, when Jesus is saying, "I go to the Father," he says, "Jesus, can you show us the Father?" And Jesus responds with, have I been with you so long and still you don't know?" I mean, Philip, he was probably a burrito shy of a combo plate. I'm just saying it. He's judging everything by faith. Or by sight and not by faith. Look at 14 again, Bartholomew, who also goes by the name Nathaniel. He's Philip's brother, but you know, he's got another thing. When he's told of Jesus, he's coming out of Nazareth, his first response is, can anything good come out of Nazareth? There is a guy who knows prejudice. Can anything good come out of Chula Vista? I don't know. But that is certainly his mindset. Verse 15, Matthew. Now, Matthew is a tax collector. He's a publican. Now, there are two types of tax collectors in that first century world. The first one was a gabbai. They pretty much handled agriculture. The second was a moksha, and they handled all kinds of import and export travel to and fro. You encountered the moksha. Now, Zacchaeus, you may remember his story, he was a great moksha. He was in charge. He was a moksha's moksha. And everybody hated the moksha, by the way. And Matthew, he was a little moksha. So he was always billing people as they came in and out of town. So let me just say this. It was his face everybody knew, and it was his face everybody hated. And Jesus picks this guy. I think you don't, if you want to win people, win friends and influence people, you don't pick somebody on the team who is universally hated, but he does. 15 again, Thomas. Now, Thomas has become the poster child for faithlessness. He is the one that everybody looks to. He's the classic, I'll believe it when I see it kind of guy. As a matter of fact, we've turned it into a colloquialism. Yeah, you remember Doubting Thomas? Are you being a Doubting Thomas? The guy makes one doubting decision, and he's remembered for the rest of his life, not for what he's done, but for what he's doubted. That's him. He picks Doubting Thomas, James, the son of Alphaeus. James, they call him James the Less. Some commentators honestly believe that James was vertically challenged. They believe that he was probably vertically, you know, short. I know, they called him Little Shorty, but I don't know. I mean, the point is simply this. There's not much said about him. We really don't read a lot about him. As a matter of fact, church history tells us that he was Matthew's brother, which means, and they believe that he was a tax collector as well. So now he's got two tax collectors on the team to convert and establish the church in Israel. You wonder what he's thinking. Verse 15. And Simon called the zealot. Now, the zealots are interesting. Zelotes in the Greek language, but certainly these guys are the Jewish answer to terrorists. Zealots were terrorists. They would commonly hide daggers in their cloaks and go up behind a Roman soldier and just shiv him and walk away. They would wait for a crowd and kill Roman soldiers. This is the kind of person that Jesus picks on the team. By the way, if there's anything that zealots hated more than Romans, you know what it was? Tax collectors. So can you imagine James and Matthew sleeping at night, wondering. How about verse 16, Judas, the son of James? He has three names, Judas, Thaddeus, Levis. He went his whole life and he just said this, I'm Judas, not Iscariot. He wanted to make sure everybody knew he wasn't that Judas, by the way. Verse 16 again, and Judas Iscariot, who also became a traitor. Now, Judas was from Judea, they principally believe from Jerusalem. So he was kind of a city guy. He thought a lot of himself, yet he was a thief. I remember John said in John chapter 12, verse 6, you remember when the oil was broken and poured over Jesus' head? He disputed that. He said, we could have sold this for 100 denarii and given it to the poor. But he didn't say that because he cared for the poor, but literally John writes, because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was in it. Judas thought a lot of himself. Judas was always self-seeking, self-serving. He was arrogant, and he was a thief. And get this, Jesus picked him. I'm talking Jesus picked him. These are the men that Jesus picks after a long night of prayer. Doesn't that stun you? Don't you wonder why? I mean, he's got 4 to 7 fishermen. He's got farmers, tradesmen, tax collectors, a zealot, and a treacherous thief. And that's his team. No training, by the way. No gifting, by the way. No schooling at all, by the way. And all of them would fail Jesus. Nice choices, Jesus. Great team you've assembled. And I ask this question, and you got to be asking the question, don't you? Jesus, why would you do this? I mean, why would you pick these guys? And you go through Europe and you find these enormous statue of apostles. You see them, John, James, you know, they're all lined up there. These guys are losers. And why would he pick it? And honestly, I believe this with my whole heart. I think he does it by divine design. I think he meant to pick them. And I believe that this is Jesus' way of shoving these people up into our grills. And if you choose to see it, it should be a comfort to you. It should be the only reason why you even came today. Number one, Jesus is willing and you are invited. That's what it tells me. Through these 12 men, he will change the world. And through you, he can change your world. He uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. I mean, he's using them to accomplish healing and in life. And their ministry is so powerful and will be so powerful that we're talking about it some 2,000 years later. Ordinary people, real people with real problems. Everybody say real.
Real.
People.
Real
problems. I mean, oh, I wish we could own this. You know, some of us just get so defeated by everything that we're not that it's almost like the enemy keeping you from everything God has to overwhelm you with everything you're not. Are you hearing me? It is so easy to be beaten down by every failure in your playbook that you can't even pick up the ball and run because you know it's over. But I want you to know, Jesus picked these guys to show you and to show me that anything is possible with him. If you're willing to trust him, doesn't matter where you've been. Doesn't matter what you've done, what you said. The only thing that matters is that Jesus picks you. I mean, in Ephesians 2:20, the whole church is built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief corner. How is this even possible? How can these kind of guys be used in such a powerful way to change their world, and the change is still happening? Ordinary people, how is it possible? Matthew 19:16, with God, all things are possible. Matthew 19:26, through the Message. No chance at all if you think you can pull it off yourself. Every chance in the world if you trust God to do it. Ordinary people just reveal an extraordinary God. And I think if there's anything that we can be really faulted for, it's this. We can be so overwhelmed with everything that we're not allowing ourselves to see everything that he is. As a matter of fact, I think some of us really work overtime to hide everything that we're not so that nobody can see everything that we're not. The problem is when we hide everything that we're not and keep it from God who can change, we don't realize the change. Now, this is what takes me to church. Number one, the only thing that made a difference in any of these apostles' life was it began with just simply they started following. So just follow. Just follow Jesus. They just started with following. Each one had an invitation, so all they did was follow. They followed him. They followed him. They just simply followed him. How does that work in your life and mine? Well, we do this thing here. We have women's study and men's study. I get that. We do that, and you're welcome to come. That's part of following. But there's another thing, too. They listened to him. I mean, it's important for you to listen to him. We did a whole study this week in rehab, and man, did I feel better after we left. We did a whole study in rehab about Jesus who says, my sheep hear my voice and they know me. And how important it is to hear his voice, not to hear your voice, not to hear their voice, the voice of your accusers, but to hear his voice. He's your shepherd. And his voice, his words are life. And their truth, and just to follow that. That's why, this is why we have daily breads here. Did you know that? We have piles of daily breads in the back. We have free Bibles. I mean, we give away more Bibles, I think, than most churches out there. We give away, I get cases of daily breads every 2 months, every two, 3 months. We take the daily bread, you can put it in the bathroom, and for, you know, the time it takes to in the bathroom, you can read the daily bread, and you can listen to God's voice. You can hear the voice of the leader, and that's what they did. They simply followed him, and they simply received his message. The message changed their lives. He was a revolutionary. By the way, they didn't just simply listen, but they watched. See, this is another reason why church is so powerful, because I love to watch God at work, and sometimes we don't see God working because we're not around the work of God. That's why church is powerful. It can be wonderful. I mean, we had Rao here, a month and a half ago. I mean, homie was staring down both barrels of terminal. He was cancer. And we prayed for him. All of us got together and prayed for him. And then Rao comes back and they said, well, I don't know. Doctor just said it's some sort of swelling now. I mean, we celebrate the healing. How do you do that? How do you celebrate it if you're not there? How do you celebrate if you're not connected and a part of it? We see things, healings in marriages, in families. We see addictions overcome. We see anger issues overcome. All kinds of things going on. But it happens as you follow and you watch. And nobody ever sees anything like this. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And then we follow. We act on faith. I want to leave you with a powerful truth, and it comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 1 in verse 26. You can turn there if you want. Just go to your right a little bit. After you hit Acts, you're going to go past Acts to Romans, and then once you get past Romans, bingo, you're there. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Bless you. I usually put verse 27 at the base of every email I write because it's my life verse. But here it is. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. Are you hearing this, folks? I mean, I want you to just embrace that for a second. He says not many, not any. I mean, there are some wise people around us. There are some mighty. There are noble. But God has chosen the foolish things to put to shame the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. And the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. I'm going to pause there. When we get together, I think we need to celebrate everything that he is through embracing everything that we're not. That's why oftentimes when we get together here and we spend time together, it's not really an ego massage that you get from me. Because I want you to embrace everything that, that is wrong or going on in your life that is wrong, so that God, when you bring it to God, he can fix it. He can fill it. I want you to embrace the emptiness so that he can fill the void. I think the worst thing that any of us ever do is deny that which is happening in our lives. And I want you to know that God chose all of those weak, despised, foolish people. All 12 of them. He chose them to change the world. Not that they would change the world, because everybody knows they were completely and totally incompetent. But God could change the world through them. And so I'm going to ask you this morning, is there something going on in your life that God really doesn't have, that you've been holding back, that you haven't really confessed that, you know, this is a problem with me? Ultimately, he wants to free you. Ultimately, he wants to not only deliver you, but he wants to deliver the world through you. And the only way that that is even remotely possible is when we come face to face with everything that we're not, so that we can take that and bring it to everything that he is, that he might make us everything that we were meant to be. Yeah. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you conclude just these verses in 1 Corinthians with the statement in verse 29 that no flesh should glory in his presence. And how wonderful that is to think that people would look at us and go, wow, they're messed up, but there's a God in heaven, because look at them. I mean, they have a problem, but God is great. Look at them. If we could just be those people who aren't afraid to be weak and aren't afraid to be flawed and aren't afraid to be foolish, because we already are, but not publicly. God, teach us to come to grips with who we are not, that we might begin to embrace and grasp hold of everything that you are. Make us, God, into what you would have us to be as we surrender everything that we're not to you. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you guys. Have a great week. I will see you Tuesday.